It's okay, no?
Yeah, yeah.
Great. Great. Okay, so, but this does not work very well in general because, as you know, the norm is not differentiable around zero, and it's not uncommon that in practice we have, we converge, the norm of u converge to zero at the optimum solution. So what we could do is square this constraint, but then you would get, if you square that and rewrite in the nonlinear way, around zero you will get degeneracy because you will have, in your Jacobian, you will have a row of zeros, basically. So we can try also to perturb this constraint by adding some epsilons, but this, of course, is problem sensitive and is not very robust in practice. So this all motivates the derivations for SOCPs. So, for instance, to convince you, I will consider this example. So here you take just a linear objective, simple example with two variables, and you'll take absolute value constraints, modulus constraints on x1 less than x2. So obviously the optimal solution is zero. And if you just write it in Nitro with the old API, you will see that you will not converge to dual, you will not get dual feasibility. So you will not have an optimal solution. You could write it as a QCQP, non-convex QCQP. But then you'll get still relatively bad behavior with 50 iterations. And with our conic formulation with Nitro, we are now able to solve it in 4 iterations. So really, it brings a lot in terms of performance. And in fact, all the developments for the conic SOCP algorithm, it started when we started having problems with one particular model, which is a Steiner model, that came from one of our academic friends. And we said we cannot solve it very well, so let's think a bit and develop something new. So here are some performance results. So here we compare the old Nitro version, Nitro 10.3, with Nitro 11 and the conic algorithm, and with Express. So on several problems, as you can see, we reach, in terms of number of iterations, the same performance as Express. So sometimes Express even gets worse. So there are cases in which you get the maximum number of iterations, so this just means that the problem is not solved. So yeah, some cases are like that. And as you can see, in some cases, Nitro 11 or Express cannot solve, whereas with Nitro 10.3 or Express cannot, whereas with our new method, we can do it quite rapidly. Of course, this is just a number of iterations, and we still need to do some improvements on the computations to make it efficient in terms of CPU, because we are a little worse than Express in terms of CPU time. So there are still developments we need to make on the linear algebra to make it more efficient in terms of flops and so on.
So it is a pure conic problem.
Sorry? These are pure conic problems. They are not nonlinear SOCPs.
And the reason that Nitro 11 needs Express is it implementation or is something fundamentally different on the algorithm that you're using?
It's something fundamentally different because we don't do the same barrier algorithm as Express. Yeah. And of course, from the internal architecture of Nitro, we are able to use this algorithm inside our branch and bound routine. So you could apply it when you want to solve mixed integer SOCPs. So which means when you have, for instance, SOCP constraints on the continuous variables, but integer variables in the other part of the constraints. So that's it for the SOCP algorithm. So there are still some developments going on, and we expect some improvements in terms of CPU time.
Yeah. Can you have integer variables in SOCP?
If they are handled by the pre-solve, yes. But in general, at the moment, let me think. No, currently I don't think you can have integer variables in the SOCP, except if you're able to remove them with the pre-solve or something like that, yeah, but currently not. Yeah. So yeah, I think, yeah, we can discuss about that later. Right? So let's see how our SOCP solvers can basically detect conic constraints. So we have developed a new API for modeling nonlinear problems in Nitro. So the idea is to make it that we want more flexibility and we want the user to be able to build its problem block by block. So saying I want to add a block of linear structures to this constraint, quadratic structures, conic constraints, and so on. So it's not only constraint by constraint, but it's sub-block by sub-block inside the constraints. So we identify special structures like linear, quadratic, conic. So this of course, in ample, makes faster function evaluations, because instead of having to go through the whole expression tree of ample, you can just do a matrix vector product. And this is why, basically, we get performance improvements. You can combine this method, this API, to combine exact and approximate derivatives. So you can do finite difference on one set of variables and exact derivative computation on another. So let's see how the API works. So here I wrote a simple problem. So we have a nonlinear objective, a quadratic part into objective, one in the constraints, and a quadratic part, a mix of linear and quadratic constraints. So in Nitro, for those of you who are familiar with the C API, you create a Nitro context, then you would say that you would add two variables. You can set an upper bound on variable zero. This is what is done here. You can add a constraint, two constraints, set the lower bound, and then you can set this lower bound vector on all constraints. Then the idea is that we load a quadratic part of the constraints in constraint zero. So here we have constraint zero, and we just write the indices of the variables and the coefficients we want to put in the quadratic part. We can do the same for the second constraint, and we can do that also for the linear part of the second constraint. So you can mix linear, quadratic, and conic blocks into different constraints. Yeah. You can also combine that with callbacks. This is what we use basically for the finite difference evaluations. So you can add a callback to the objective and add linear part, a quadratic part to the objective as well, with this function kn add object linear struct. So it's a bit close to what is done, I think, in the latest Julia MassOpt interface. So you have blocks of quadratic and linear constraints. And then, so of course, you can solve the problem by setting an algorithm in Nitro, solve, and get a solution. And then you just freeze the memory as usual. So this is the implementation is quite stable now, and we will work in the future on having some interfaces, so probably in Julia and other languages to extend the modeling capabilities of Nitro in other languages. And the main point of this new API is that it brings a lot in terms of computational performance. So here is a benchmark of QCQP problems, which are quite big. So as you can see, the Hessian contains several, so almost half a million non-zero elements in some cases. So you can see this one, for instance, we drastically reduce the solve time by reducing the evaluation time of the callbacks by making use of this new API. So, yeah. Yeah, that's it. So that's the second main feature of Nitro 11. And now I will talk about.
Another couple of minutes.
So now one of the latest features is the new preconditioner. Because for those of you who are familiar with Nitro, who have used Nitro already, you can see that sometimes in one column you have CG iterations and you have a lot of conjugate gradient iterations. So because Nitro algorithm reverts in conjugate gradient iterations when it gets into troubles, numerical problems. And these CG iterations, they cost a lot in terms of CPU. And we'd like to, it's something you want to always to reduce this iterative linear algebra part. And because sometimes it's really a bottleneck. And I will show you some examples. So the idea is that because all this comes from ill conditioning of this problem. And so the idea is that you want to use a preconditioner for that. And we came up with a new preconditioner design that brings a lot of improvements to this method, basically. So preconditioning, as you may know, you just apply a linear scaling of the variables to reshape your problem and make it well conditioned. So of course, we do this not at the beginning, but we do it dynamically at every iteration. So you can expect that there is a trade-off between the complexity we get to derive this preconditioner and the benefit of it in terms of numerical performance. And this is what you will see, basically. So one of the challenges for this development was the fact that we have linear constraints here. So it's not trivial to do preconditioning on a conjugate gradient with linear constraints. So we had to do a lot of some derivations. And internally, what we do finally is an incomplete Cholesky factorization, and we apply these conjugate gradient steps at every iteration. So here is, we basically form a dense matrix with the linear constraints. So this approach is somehow limited to problems with not a lot of linear constraints. But you will see that you can still get some good performance. So we have some new options for this feature. We have CG precon and CG PMM to control the density, the accuracy of the Cholesky factorization that will give you basically the complexity. If you have a CG PMM which is small, you will expect less operations, but maybe worse conditioning, worse improvement with the preconditioner. So you need to tune a bit with that. And it has some effect, actually. So here is one example on inequality constraint problems. So as you can see, in terms of iteration, we completely drastically improve algorithm 2. But of course, this method can also apply for algorithm 1 when it falls back to CG. So here is, in terms of number of iterations, on bound constraint problems. And now I'll show you what we have in terms of iterations on equality and inequality constraint problems. And as you can see, we get the same behavior, but sometimes sometimes very much, sometimes not so much. So it's something really that's problem dependent and that's sometimes hard to tune. So basically, in all the cases, preconditioner behaves well and drastically reduces the number of iterations. But, and what we have is that it also works here on most of the cases in terms of CPU time. So here, if you take, for instance, OPTC-DEC3, you see that you have almost divided by more than 100 number of iterations, CG iterations, and you will get the same in terms of CPU time. But on some problems, you don't have the same behavior because the preconditioning operations cost you and are somehow not balanced by the benefit, numerical benefit. So you don't get such a big improvement. And in some cases, it's even worse with the preconditioner in terms of CPU, but better in terms of number of iterations. So it's a feature that needs to be tuned. And we are currently working on some tricks to make it improve the efficiency. Yeah, thank you very much. So that's it. So we have the linear solvers as well in Nitro. So this I will skip, but we got basically MA86 and MA97. With basically comparable performance than as MKL Paradiso. And so that's it for Nitro 11, and now it's your turn to try and tell us what you think.